panel speaker series. Tonight I'm honored to have Detective Sean Gorman, Fire Chief Dave Gruber from the Bethel Park Fire Department, and John Bauer, Supervisor from Tri-Community EMS South. Welcome, gentlemen. And tonight we're going to talk about living well in your house. Living well is just more than eating healthy and exercising. We have to live right in our house. Our house is a big part of our everyday living, and there's stuff that we do in our house that we shouldn't be doing. And these gentlemen are going to give us some ideas on how to live better in our houses. Welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So I know you guys see different things that people really don't think about in their houses that, you know, cause accidents or fires or, you know, break-ins. So if you any tips that you can give us, you know, someone told me, and I'm not sure if this is true, the biggest, one of the most fires are a lot of fires start in the dryer. You know, you leave, and I was shocked when I heard that. I'm like, really?
Yeah, people don't clean out the lint. Simple stuff like that. Just something as easy as that can prevent a fire. And okay. We have several of them every year.
Someone said that to me, and I was like, how is it? And they're like, a lot of time you leave it, you leave the house, and you leave the dryer on, not thinking, and it causes more than it needs to. So,
yeah,
I'll let you guys take it away.
Good, Sean.
Go first. All right. Well, I'll talk about the home security safety aspect of things, what our residents can do to better protect themselves. Obviously, the number one is securing your home, locking your doors, and locking your vehicles in your driveway. As you know, we've had an increase in that in this past year, mainly due to the fact that people are working from home now. So they're not going into the office, they're not leaving their homes, so burglaries are down, but thefts from vehicles are up because criminals are trying to find a way to steal property, money, and things to sell. So please, whatever you do at all times, secure your homes, secure your car. Even if you're home, keep your screen door locked. I know the weather's nice, you know, when the weather warms up, I mean, still keep the screen door closed, prevents any unwanted guests, and it gives you a barrier and extra protection. Windows, a lot of windows, especially newer ones, have little stop switches that can at least prevent the window from being opened all the way. Sliding doors have security bars, things like that.
What happens if you have older windows or older sliding doors? Is there something you can put in there to help secure it?
Yes, there's aftermarket devices or even wooden boards and stuff to act as security for sliding doors and windows, things like that. Also, with door deadbolt sill plates, they usually include in the kits longer screws and the shorter screws. We encourage people to use the longer screws to have a better secure deadbolt, better secure locks. Same with the hinges on that side, so the hinge side isn't vulnerable for somebody trying to force entry into a house. So basic building and vehicle security is essential.
So like lights around the house, the more the better?
Absolutely.
Motion sensors?
Absolutely. We encourage motion lights. Just general lighting, even when you're away from home, setting lights on timers, just keeping the place illuminated, especially at night, obviously, and criminals are looking for places to hide, especially with our thefts from vehicles. We're catching them on video with a lot of the residents' cameras, which are excellent, and I'll gladly talk about that too. But when they're hiding from us, if we get a call and we get in the area, we're watching them on video duck behind bushes and run into yards that aren't well lit. So the lighting is huge. I would also encourage with landscaping too. Trimming landscaping back from windows and around porches makes it open, visible from the street so that our officers on patrol can see it and anybody passing by has better visibility of the house, you know, less likely for people to hide. So landscaping, lighting are two big, you know, aesthetic issues that can really help reduce crime.
Okay. Well, from our home safety point, as far as the fire department goes, the number one biggest fire safety item is to have working smoke detectors and carbon monoxide detectors in your home. It's one of the biggest things that we can tell people to do. We have had fires here in Bethel Park that the smoke detectors have saved lives. A smoke detector normally lasts in the area of 7 to 10 years. If you take the smoke detector off, look at the back, there's normally a date on it when it was manufactured. If it's older than 10 years old, take it down, go to one of the local hardware stores, and go ahead and get a new smoke detector. You should have smoke detectors, at least one on every level of your home, in a common area, out and around your bedroom and stuff, so you can hear if it goes off in the middle of the night. Carbon monoxide detectors, once again, you could have one on every level of the home. They normally last 5 to 7 years, we tell people. We get a lot of false alarms and stuff. A simple way to know the batteries are going bad, you should replace the batteries every time we change the clocks. We tell people batteries aren't always bad at that point, but they should be changed, because once again, you need a good working smoke detectors and carbon monoxide detectors in your home. That's the number one item. This time of year, we can tell you that normally if it's cold outside, obviously, if you have space heaters, things along those lines, make sure you have them plugged in. You really shouldn't use a extension cord or anything to plug them in. But if you do, make sure it's as short as possible and you have a properly rated extension cord. Normally it'll tell you in the directions, if you can put an extension cord to it or whatever. So those are I would say it's for sure this time of year, two of the biggest fire safety items.
What about Christmas lights and lighting?
Christmas lights and lighting and all. Once again, you want to have the proper rated extension cord. You're going to have stuff outside. You want to make sure you have a good outdoor extension cord to plug everything into. Good idea is to make sure that you seal up the plugs, any plugs. Make sure the snow can't get in them, water isn't going to get in them. Things along those lines. So, just make sure you don't plug. I think they normally tell you no more than 3 sets of lights plugged into each other. I know some people try and put freaking 8 sets of lights together, and that tends to be a problem. We're in the business of accidents, so we see some of that stuff just about every year.
I had a relative that I used to tell him his artificial tree was going to melt. He had so many lights on it. I'm serious.
I know, even in my house, my wife tries to plug a whole bunch of stuff in together, and we got to separate things out so we don't have any problems. And like I said, it's simple things like that can stop a big problem. So,
okay. What do you guys see? I'm sure you see a lot.
Falls are a big part of what we see, and falls is the number one cause of injury, fatal and non-fatal, in those that are 65 years or older. And once somebody that age has a fall, it's generally hard, especially if they break a bone, fracture a hip, it's especially hard for them to come back to the level they were originally. And the elderly people, 65 and older, usually are taking medicines that might cause them to be lightheaded and dizzy. They're inactive, not as active as they used to be. And so when they are moving around, it's harder for them to do that. So some of those things are the cause of the 65 and older. And we see a lot of people that fall, and we do a lot of lift assists, people that fall and aren't injured, and we help them up and get them back in their chair or the bed or wherever they fell from.
Is there like any one thing that causes the most trips? Furniture?
Well, there's numerous things. Like in the bathroom, you want to make sure that you have handrails in your tub or shower, and no loose throw rugs in the bathroom. And if you have water spilled, you want to make sure you clean it up. In the kitchen, you want to not reach up high for objects. You want to have things that you use most at waist level so you can grab it and you don't have to reach up. And if you do have to go up high, don't stand on a chair, which people do, or use a stepladder, but use a stepladder or a step stool that has a handle that you can hold on to. In the bedroom, we want to make sure that they have a clear path from their bed to the bathroom, because we see that all the time when we go in houses, that there's stuff all over the floor, which are tripping hazards. And make sure there's a clear path, there's a light that works and it's easily accessible that you can turn on at night so you don't trip when you go to the bathroom. And use handrails or handles in the bathroom to get up and off, on and off the commode. And In stairwells, we want to make sure we're using the handrails, and no carpets on the stairwells. Don't stack items in the stairwells that can cause a tripping hazard. Those are some of the things they can do to avoid falls, and that's what we want to do, avoid the fall. We want to avoid an injury from the fall that's not going to let them get back to the level they were.
What about the like the push-on lights that stay on in the stairwells? Are they a good?
They're a good thing. The more light they have, the better, because as we get older, we all know our eyes aren't as well as they used to be. So the more light we have, the better to let us see what we're walking or where we're walking.
Dave, let me bring this over to you now. Okay. Just like in a fire, you know, with the stuff on the floor and the clutter, does that make it a little more dangerous, a lot more?
Yeah, if from a resident standpoint, yeah, anything extra that's laying around, one, is a fire hazard, obviously. Two, if you're trying to get out, things are dark, smoky, you know, you have a problem in the house, you'd be tripping over stuff, you have a problem, and it slows us down as far as once we get there and get into the house and can't see, getting around things, you know, to where we need to be. So, yes, it's definitely a hazard.
Okay. And Sean, I'm assuming it'd be a definite hazard if you had to break in and the police have to come in. I mean, that's going to slow down the police, obviously. I'm sure they're arising here.
Sure, and we respond with fire and EMS frequently, yeah. So we're often there as well trying to access a patient or assist in a fire scene, or if we get there before them, doing our best to evacuate or treat. Evacuate, and yeah. And those obstacles hinder us at fire and EMS at yeah. You know, being able to potentially help somebody, especially this time of year with the space heaters and the debris inside houses, navigating through some of the houses can be challenging.
Hey, let me ask you, you brought up space heaters. What if I've known people to use kerosene heaters in their house. How dangerous is something like that?
Well, that's having a fuel in your house. I mean, we tell you don't keep your gas cans or anything like that, you know, in your garage, keep them out in the shed. So to actually have a kerosene heater in the house, that's just like having a gas can, you know. It's hopefully there's better things nowadays with the space heaters and stuff. And if you use things carefully, keep a 3-foot area around the space heater and stuff, watch the kids, watch the pets and stuff around it. You know, they can be safe. You just got to make sure you do everything that you should to make it safe. And, you know, you can be very safe using them, and it'll help you warm the house up for it.
Sean, what is the biggest area where criminals try to break in? Is it the back, the side? Is it different?
It varies, but obviously criminals don't like to be caught. They don't like to be seen. They're usually taking advantage of a crime of opportunity. Either something being left unlocked, which we see more often than not, that the simple locking and securing of your house and your vehicle deters a criminal that might not want to take that extra step to cause alarm or break a window. But when they do, they're most likely doing it in a place where they're concealed by shrubbery around behind a building, or a porch area that's kind of secluded. And one of the big, aside from the lighting deterrence and the landscaping, is having cameras. And that's a tremendous, not only a deterrent that somebody's going to want to avoid a house that has cameras, but also that after the fact, when we respond and we investigate, it is extremely helpful to us. Not just the resident themselves that may be a victim, but their neighbors. And I can't tell you how many incidents we've been able to solve because a neighbor had a camera that was pointed at least far enough out into the yard or the street that was able to capture a person or vehicle of interest for us. So the cameras have been tremendous, and every time we have an incident and we reach out on social media and to our Crime Watch group asking for footage, I've been impressed with the increasing number of responses we're getting from residents, and it's extraordinarily helpful, especially at 3 a.m. when there's not a whole lot of eyes looking out. There's still cameras running.
That is a good thing. John, besides the tripping hazard, what else do you guys see that, you know?
Well, most of our calls are medical emergencies. Difficulty breathing, chest pain, things like that. We used to see a lot of trauma years ago, but that has since gone, and most of our calls are medical. And the majority of our calls are for people that are elderly. We know that we have a big elderly population in the community, and we have several complexes that have a lot of elderly people in them. So we go to those quite frequently, the retirement communities, the apartment complexes, and we see a lot of elderly people for numerous complaints.
Is there one area of the house, like the kitchen or the bathroom, that's most dangerous for the elderly?
Not really, but as long, like what I was talking about, fall prevention, as long as they keep the areas clear and safe, that's a lot better for them and would prevent them from falling or having an injury. And it helps us gain access to the patient too. As they were talking about clutter, we've been in several houses that there's been a small pathway from the front door to the where the person is sitting. And our crews have knocked things over because there's stacks and the stacks are falling on them as they're trying to make their way to the patient. So,
and that can't, overall, that can't be healthy for anybody because, you know, you breathe all that extra dust and, you know.
Yeah, and it's not a healthy environment. And when that does occur, we try to confer with the police, the fire department, and code enforcement to see if there's a remedy to helping that person and making their environment safer.
Yeah, Dave.
No, I just kind of on a different angle too. I think one of the most important things from all three of our departments are Bethel Park. You can call 911 for Bethel Park, but you can also call, and the best way to do it would be 412-833-2000. That'll get you the dispatchers here in Bethel Park a lot quicker for police, fire, and EMS, and get people on the road. I know from our angle of it, as the fire department, we're 100% volunteers, so we have we don't always have somebody at the station. So the quicker that we can get the dispatchers here to dispatch us out, the quicker we can get people to the station, the chief's on the road to the call, and we can get you help fastest way possible. And so
another point is addresses on houses.
Yes.
We rely on those addresses, and if we can't see the address, that's going to make it harder for us to find the person that needs help. And that delay could mean life or death. And when we go out and do school programs, we tell the little kids to go out and stand on your curb and look at your house. If you can see your house number from the curb, then we can see it too. And if you can't see it from the curb, have mom or dad put it out there. So having an address visible for us to see helps us tremendously, all three departments, in responding to their need.
Yeah, definitely.
In addition to that, it's a municipal ordinance as well that requires the letters to be a certain height to be visible from the roadway. So we obviously encourage that for both safety reasons and, you know, for all three of us.
Let's go to the outside of the house. So what do you three see at the outside of the house that, you know, injuries, you know, like working on your car, is that, do you see a lot of that, or just working around the house, or like landscaping injuries?
Not a lot of landscaping injuries. We see in the summer, in the heat, we see heart attacks when they're out cutting the grass and it's 90 degrees with 100% humidity and they're not hydrating, and they're trying to cut the grass in one swoop and they get dehydrated and pass out. We see that frequently during the summer months.
What about during the winter when they're shoveling their walks?
That's a big thing too. When they're shoveling their snow, they need to take a break. They need to use a shovel that's easy for them to lift, and they want to push rather than lift the snow. They want to stay warm, and they want to layer to stay warm. And it's important to take a break when you're doing it, because it's a strenuous activity, pushing and shoveling snow.
And they should stay hydrated during that too.
Definitely.
I know a lot of people think, oh, it's the winter, I don't need as much
Yeah, but they're
water or whatever.
They're in all that heavy clothes and they're sweating and dehydrating, so they need to hydrate, make sure they're doing it, and take a break. Don't try to do it all at once.
From our angle on that, on the outside, one of the biggest, most frequent calls we get, and I know the police get too, are people trying to clean up in the spring and in the fall. They're burning their leaves, they're burning old shrubs and stuff that they've cleaned up outside. It's actually an Allegheny County ordinance that you can't open burn in Allegheny County.
What do you mean by open burn?
Meaning burning your shrubs, your leaves, and all that kind of stuff. The you're allowed, they sell those fire pits, you'll see.
Okay.
You're allowed no more than 3 foot. I believe the area is 3 foot around. The fire can't be more than 3 foot high. The fire can't be more than 3 foot like above that. You got to have it at least, I believe it's 30 feet away from the house. We have people that like to burn garbage, make a lot of smoke. Maybe that doesn't bother you, but know that you have neighbors that might be older that might have, problems breathing and stuff like that. And it does affect them. They can't sit out on their porch because, like I said, people are just doing simple things like burning cardboard boxes and leaves and trash and stuff that you're not allowed to be doing in Allegheny County. So,
as long as it's recreational, you can do it.
Yeah.
So you can use a fire pit or a fire ring.
Fire pit or fire ring, yeah. And like I said, it's supposed to be no more than 3 foot around. I know some people extend that, but like I said, the biggest thing is really what you're burning. If you're just burning clean firewood, it's not a big deal, but I know we do have some people that like to burn boxes and garbage and all that kind of stuff, and it's...
That always surprises me, too, the number of calls we get where people, intelligent adults, are burning leaves, pine tree parts of their, and then construction debris. Yeah. So paint, they take off their baseboards or their casing around their doors, and they're burning it to get rid of it, but it's covered in paint, and it's chemicals that are being released, and it's kicking up all the smoke, and then all of a sudden we get calls, people thinking there's a house fire somewhere, and they're surprised when we show up because they don't understand that, if you're responsible about it, you're burning, seasoned firewood, like a recreational fire, you have a water source nearby, a hose or a bucket of water or something to extinguish it, you're not going to get bothered by us if you're enjoying yourself and you're not letting it get out of control and you're not, disturbing the other neighbors. That
you can actually go on to our website, BethelParkVFC.com, and there's a spot there that you can click on the link that will actually bring up the county's open burning laws. It tells you what you're allowed to do, how far away from the house you have to be, and things along
how
those lines.
How far away from the neighbors.
Yeah, all that kind of stuff, and like what you're allowed to burn and all. So
it does kind of amaze me if people burn leaves, because a couple of those leaves go up and they hit something else that's really dried out. I mean, you can have a big fire in your backyard or your neighbor's backyard.
Mm-hmm.
Or five houses down.
Five houses down. I mean, that's, it is what it is, but I hope everyone's responsible. What do you see? We're talking about a house and everything. What about cars? What do you guys see with cars? This is part of living well, too. I mean, with accidents and, stuff like that. What can we do?
The first thing when you bring up cars and homes, not only to lock your doors, I'll say it again, lock your doors. I'll turn to the camera and say, lock your doors.
I grew up in the city. That's the first thing I do.
It's still amazing to me that the number of people that will take reports afterwards and say, well, Bethel Park's a safe community. Well, it is a very safe community, but it's not immune from crime just like anywhere else. In addition to that, the number of people that leave valuables in their car, large amounts of cash or electronics, and firearms. We've had, I believe, 3 firearms this year alone stolen from unlocked vehicles, and it happens year after year. And that translates to the home, too. If you're going to be a firearm owner and you're going to, accept that right and take it seriously, then you also have to be responsible to remove it from your vehicle, not leave it unattended in your car, and not leave it unattended at your home, too. Make sure it's locked away, especially with children, neighbors, if you have young kids and they're coming over. Just make sure it's secured and put away. Don't leave it in your car unattended. They sell lock boxes and things for vehicles that are mounted in if you're going to be leaving your car for a brief period of time. But when you're parking for the night or you're leaving for, please remove valuables and firearms. The number of times we recover it you know, just today we recovered a firearm that was in outside of Detroit. 3 years ago, it was stolen from Bethel Park. And for the last 3 years, it's made it around. We don't know how it was used, if what crimes it might have been used in, but it was out there. And I would hate, you know, as a gun owner and a police officer, I would hate for something to happen with one of my firearms, and then it's used in a criminal way that way. Yeah. So, but going back to the vehicles themselves with your home, I'd say parking. I'd say for all three of us, especially with the holidays, guests coming over.
And snow removal,
absolutely, is the number of times that, you know, our police cars will fit in pretty small areas, but fire trucks and ambulances don't. So squeezing down a residential road where, you know, aunts, uncles, and relatives are all visiting and lining both sides, we ask you to please just park on one side of the road, tell your friends and family coming over, keep the vehicles to one side, leave room for the driveways, and park facing facing the flow of traffic.
That's true for our public works trucks, too.
Absolutely.
It's snowing, you know, it's winter. You're going to have people over and it's going to snow, and they can't get down there. It just makes it more hazardous for everybody else traveling.
And the fact that they're in your driveway at night, if you remove them for snow removal, also we know, you know, we see historically some of our criminals that are breaking into cars at night or looking to unlock cars are more likely to try the ones that are out on the street because it looks like they're just walking past. Versus if they go into a driveway, they're now making an intentional act to trespass on someone's property. So the person that's not, as the criminal that may not be as brazen, may walk past one that's in somebody's driveway because they just don't want to step on the property and draw attention to themselves.
One of our vehicle things I would tell you is springtime, summertime, fall time, people gotta go to the gas station to get gas for their snow blowers, their lawn mowers, their weed whackers and all that. Make sure when you're getting gas that you have a approved gasoline container. Make sure it's up to date. I know people, you go into houses and people have an odor of gas in their house. Well, gasoline only comes from a couple places. It just doesn't magically appear in your basement. So old metal, you know, fuel cans and things that you have, probably good time to get rid of them. The fuel doesn't so much rot it out, but just in your damp basement and stuff, it'll start making the seams leak, and then you get that odor of gasoline.
So is plastic better than metal?
That's all they sell now for the most part, unless you're buying real expensive. I know we have some metal gas cans on our fire trucks, but they're not normally something you find in Home Depot or the hardware store to put gas in.
I remember when I was a kid, you seen them everywhere. That's all
they
sold.
Yeah, that's all they sold. And that's what I said. It's probably time, if you have old metal ones, to go and get an approved, you know, one from the hardware store that's just for gas.
So how long should you keep even a plastic one? Is there a certain...
I don't know if there's really a date date for that, but, you know, it depends on how many people are using it. If you own a lawn service and it's getting used 5-6 times a day, it's not going to last nearly as long as one that, you know, Grandma Smith has down the street that's only getting used every so often to cut grass, so...
One of our points outside the house, if we get called to the house, is turn your porch light on at night so you can look out for us if you're able to. Have somebody look out for us to guide us in and guide us to the patient. And when we're talking about parking, if there's cars in front of the house and in the driveway blocking the sidewalk, it's going to impede us getting in to the patient and out with the stretcher. So we want to try to make a clear path for us in towards the patient. And turn your light on, and if you can, have somebody look out for us to flag us down and make sure we're going to the right spot.
And I think that would work for all three of us, that if you can make it to the door, turn the light on, have somebody wave us down, because it's not always, as we mentioned earlier, the street addresses and stuff on your house, people don't always have that, or it's hard to find when we're buzzing down the street trying to, I know it's around here, but where?
Where's it at? What do you find in cars, just with people driving in general? I mean,
I personally have noticed that there's a lot of lack of courtesy in driving lately, and to put it mildly, and there's a lot of people that aren't paying attention. They're distracted. They're on their cell phone. They're texting. And that's very dangerous, because when they're distracted, that means they're not paying attention to the road. And when they don't pay attention to the road, that's when they're going to involve accidents. They could hit somebody, hit another car, and cause injury and damage. So distracted driving is a big problem that we see, and it causes a lot of problems and accidents.
I'm thinking cell phone's the biggest distraction.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, definitely.
Yeah. When I'm, all of our cars have Bluetooth now, so, it's, you can answer it, but it's still probably, there's still a little distraction there. And I think a lot of people, when that rings, they get that, oh, was that the jump?
Yeah, I know just driving around and down the street or whatever, you'll see people all the time, like, they ain't even so much talking, they're like, whether they're reading the news or what they're doing, you should be driving, not.
We saw a person the other day, they were watching a movie.
Yeah.
On their cell phone kind of as they were driving.
Amazing.
I don't know if you guys have seen it, but with the increase of the phones, is drivers wearing their earbuds and their headphones while they're driving to listen to music or whatever reason, which is illegal because it obviously impedes your ability to hear not only other car horns or people trying to drive, but our emergency vehicles. And any one of us can say how many times we've driven with our lights and siren on and cars aren't getting out of the way, and it's because people are distracted, they're on their phones, they're not paying attention, or their music's too loud, or they have these headphones in.
And then all of a sudden they hear you and they slam on their brakes. It's like, geez.
Or swerve quickly. Yeah.
It's like, oh.
So, you know.
Sean, remind the people what the law is on when an emergency vehicle is approaching.
When an emergency vehicle is approaching, you're required to pull over to the right part of the road as far off as you can get and come to a complete stop until that vehicle passes. And that includes emergency vehicles coming towards you in the opposite lane, because with cars pulling out of driveways or turning out, we've often had to go down the middle of the road to try to span traffic. So unless you're on a divided highway where there's a physical barrier or a divided greenway, which we do not have in Bethel Park, you are required. Those small raised medians like up on Fort Couch and 19, those don't count. That's still an open highway because vehicles can travel over it, and there's plenty of times where we've had to take our vehicles over those small medians to go into the oncoming lane to get around traffic. So,
just going to ask you about that, because 51 has some of the high barriers, then they have some of the low.
Sure. Yeah. If it's an open barrier, it's considered an open highway. If you have to have a barrier that can completely stop you from going into oncoming traffic.
Besides distracted driving, what's the number two cause of accidents? Is that can be DUI?
We definitely have a number of them. We're down, at least in my experience over the years. We probably average 6 to 10 DUIs a month. That used to be closer to 15 to 20 in years past. I think a lot of that is due to not only awareness and enforcement. Our DUI task forces, where we're announcing that we're going to be out during the holidays or weekends or certain events with extra personnel doing either checkpoints or roving patrols, but also rideshare programs, Uber, Lyft, which I applaud, are being smarter about, finding a safe ride if they've been drinking. So that's huge. And I think just overall, our accidents are distracted driving, simple stop sign, red light violations, people in a hurry. We see that all the time. One of our biggest complaints, into our department is traffic related. Residents reporting speeding vehicles. We'll refer to our traffic division, and they'll sit in a neighborhood or watch a stop sign, and 90% of the time, it's the residents from that neighborhood that we're pulling over. And in some cases, even the person that complained to us. And they said, well, I normally don't speed, but I was in a hurry. Well, you called us complaining about all the cars running down the street. And you're one of the violators.
You call, so, and then you're the one that gets trapped.
It happens. So, just having that courtesy of, especially in the residential areas, you wouldn't want to see it in your street. Yeah. So,
you have a lot of problems with school buses and stuff. People not stopping for
school bus violations are pretty regular. Our one traffic officer actually, most of his time is focused on receiving those complaints from the school district. Most of those buses are now equipped with cameras, not only internal cameras, but outside to capture license plates. And the bus drivers have forms that they can immediately write down the plates.
That's a good
thing. That gets referred to our traffic division. they contact the vehicle owner and in many cases issue a citation, which is a pretty hefty one.
That's a good thing, because when my son was in elementary school, his bus stop was on the corner of our street, 98. And people just, I'm like, don't, it's a bus driver. I said, and we called a few times, and they came out and looked, and all of a sudden people were getting written up, and they stopped. I'm like, I don't see the bus, you know. It's kind of hard to miss that big bus.
Yeah, big yellow thing.
Yep, and it applies the same way with the divided highway aspect of emergency vehicles. If it's an open two-lane road, four-lane road, whatever, then traffic in all directions has to come to a complete stop until those red lights are taken off.
So, guys, what would your one biggest takeaway to stay safe in your house be from your perspective, Sean?
From ours, from a police standpoint, it is securing your home, and mostly, if you see something, say something. Call us immediately. If something looks out of place, somebody in the neighborhood, somebody coming to your door, anything that's suspicious, no matter what time of day, is calling us immediately. That 833-2000 number goes straight to our dispatch, and they can be relaying that information to us. Oftentimes, after the fact, as a detective, I'm following up with people a day later and find out that they heard or saw something at night, but they brush it off as not that important. Even if it just slightly, you know, perks your ears a little and seems a little out of place, call us. The worst case scenario, we show up, everything checks out, and you know we were in the area and had a presence.
Speaking of salesmen knocking on the door tonight, aren't they supposed to have a permit from municipality?
Correct.
Do that?
Yep. Solicitors, both for-profit and non-profit, are required to have a permit, which they can obtain through the police, the records office, and they can come in during business hours to obtain that with their ID. And it just verifies that we identified them, they're issued a permit from the police chief, and they're able to wear that, and it spans for a certain period of time, so it expires, they have to renew it. And it's just that kind of extra peace of mind that people going around the neighborhoods have been vetted and documented, and their purposes and who they work for. And if there's any concerns or questions, we'll get a call. Our dispatchers have that list and can say, oh, yes, we know that person, or there was a suspicious person in my neighborhood walking around, and yes, we know that Verizon is going around soliciting door-to-door. So it helps us be aware of who's in certain neighborhoods. And allow them to do it safely and legally.
From our aspect of things, I would tell you, make sure that you have working smoke detectors and CO alarms. Make sure you check things monthly. Make sure there's always that little test button that's loud and annoying, I know, but make sure it's working monthly. And make sure you change the batteries every time we change the clocks,
What alarms should you have in your house? Fire and carbon monoxide?
Yeah, smoke detectors and carbon monoxide detectors. There is no odor or anything for carbon monoxide. You don't know. I heard a call for on the county channel today to somebody. I don't know if it was in Mount Oliver, but they said they had an odor of carbon monoxide in the house. Carbon monoxide has no odors. Yeah. So you don't know it's there until you start feeling sick we come and check things out. And sometimes you don't know you're sick. They can have a bad outcome. So, for sure, make sure you have working smoke detectors, carbon monoxide detectors in your house.
When I was a kid, now I'm going back here, they used to have, is there a way that you guys would like identify if there's kids in the house? Is there anything? They used to have those
with Tot Finder stickers. Yeah. They used to have them.
I'm going way back with that one.
Yeah. They used to have, we used to tell you to put them on there. Then for a while they were telling you not to put them on there because we would show up and spend all kind of time looking for kids that actually weren't in the house and stuff.
For 20 years.
I believe they're now back to you can find them. You can look on Amazon or whatever. We'll sell you them again. We do look, one of the first things that crews do when they get on scene is we walk around the house looking for anything from the outside and stuff first, and those are one of the things we do look for, so.
Well, Bethel has, a lot of ranch houses, split level and two-story. You have a two-story. Should you have one of those ladders that would...
You can. Yeah, I mean, that's always a good thing for the kids. You just got to be, have them have them be careful. Hopefully we're there quick enough with the police and EMS. Yeah. You know, if they are stuck in their room, make sure you teach them to put a towel down at the base of the door to keep the smoke from getting in, pound on the windows and stuff, and, you know, just be as safe as you can.
Good point, too, is we used to teach kids that if you can't get out and escape, take your pillow off your bed and throw it out the window. Because pillows aren't supposed to be laying out in the lawn. And if we come to the scene and we see a pillow laying there, that's going to cause us to look up. And that's a good signal that there's somebody that threw that out that needs help getting out.
Never. That's a very good idea. That's a very good idea. That's the first time I've actually heard that. So, from EMS standpoint, John.
Well, the fall prevention is a key point. Like I said, that the majority of people that fall and break a hip never regain, go back to where they started. And that's usually that leads to the decline in their health. Make sure you're fall safe in your house, clear the objects, well lighted, no throw rugs around, loose rugs, anything like that. And another thing is, if you're taking medications, write the medications down and have a list for them. It's easier for us when we go to the hospital and we can tell the hospital this is the medications they're taking. A lot of times we go into a house and we say, are they taking medications? And they bring this big bin out with 25 bottles of medicines and say, yeah, here's what they're taking. So it helps us and the hospital and the doctors if we have a list of what medication the person's taking and any medical history they have and allergies. If that's readily available, that speeds us up in our process of helping them. Okay. We don't have to go through each ball and write it down. We can have a list and we can treat the person better and quicker.
Okay, that's a very good idea. Let me ask you one thing, Sean. Which should, maybe all three of you can answer, people keep in their car during the winter in case they get a flat tire, you know, they get stuck in the snow, you know, which good tools?
Well, we put that out, and I know in our chronicles every year, the safe driving tips, and one of those things is keeping extra clothing, jackets, or blankets for warmth if you would get stranded. You know, food, you know, some non-perishable stuff that, you know, act for food. But a big thing, too, is to tell your friends or family where you're going and what your destination is. I know, as we've spoken about, we have an older population here who still is maintaining their independence, but they're not telling people where they're going. So, you know, we end up going on welfare checks because a neighbor hadn't seen, you know, seen their elderly neighbor, and then after us and fire EMS showing up with a ladder trying to look in, thinking maybe they're injured inside, and we find out that they went to go visit a relative yesterday and just didn't tell anybody. So I think one of the big takeaways that we could probably all relate to is just checking on your neighbors, especially with the smoke detectors, especially the trip hazards. The folks watching this show may say, well, I have this all covered, I'm aware of all this, but reach out to your neighbors, find out if, are there smoke detectors up, are there, do they have loose rugs around the kitchen and bathroom, are they practicing good home security? But this time of year, you know, Christmas time, New Year, people are traveling to see family. Let your neighbors know your travel plans, you know, find a trusted neighbor that you can trust with a key or your garage code, that if something would happen, a water leak or whatever, we could get in. But also that knows your plans and can check, bring your mail in, bring your paper in, so that, you know, a big deterrent, again, for criminals is they start seeing that mail or newspaper piling up, they know nobody's home. They can come, especially in the snow, just walk around the house, put footprints in the snow is simple enough to try to show that the house is occupied or lived in is another deterrent. So just neighbors being neighbors, and sometimes you don't see it in this day and age all that
and
well.
And if you have an elderly neighbor in your house, in your neighborhood, check on them. You know, stop in and say, hi, do you need anything? How are you doing? Just that contact, brief contact for several minutes assures them that there's somebody there that cares, and also they're checking to see if the person needs anything, if they're healthy, if they're... you know, able to do what they need to do. And just that little bit of, you know, 5 minutes, hey, how you doing? Do you need anything? That really means a big difference.
We have an elderly neighbor on the one side, and you know, my wife or I will call her every other day or something. Just during the summer, she's out. She's still very active. I'm like, Jim, just don't cut the. I'll trim your grass. Don't, you know, like you're. It's 95 degrees out. Don't start trimming it. Just we can get to that.
You know? I know from our end, and I know John and Sean from the fire department. The older, the bigger buildings, apartment buildings, retirement communities and stuff, it's always good to check in with your neighbor, let them know if you're going somewhere, because if there actually is a fire, I know one of the things EMS helps us out tremendously with, the police also helps us evacuate things. I know John's given me lists before, you know, everybody's accounted for, except maybe these three apartments, we don't know where they're at. All right, did they pass out in the stairwell? You know, trying to get out the building and stuff like that. So it's if you have a buddy that you can tell, you know, that lives next door and says, hey, I'm going to my family's house or whatever for the weekend, that helps us out tremendously, that we're not looking for apartment 303 and where the heck are they, and nobody, you know, knows where they're at.
Our neighborhood, if you're going on vacation or you're going away for a couple of days, you usually tell a couple of neighbors, hey, just keep an eye out, just, you know, we're going to be gone.
We had a large house fire years ago right up the street where, and it was, again, I think due to space heaters and some debris in the house, but it turns out we spent over an hour trying to find out if the people were in there. You're sending firefighters in there, putting them in danger, trying to search a house, come to find out that they went to visit a relative. It was during the holidays, but that was an hour or more of us. Yeah. Fire personnel inside,
worrying about
making phone calls to friends,
be,
family, knocking on doors, and nobody knew. So it just resource wise, and for us, and especially for them going into those situations, you don't have to send a firefighter into a dangerous situation if you know that there's not a person. They don't need to put themselves in that situation.
Yeah. Well, gentlemen, I thank you for tonight. A lot of great information. I hope you know, people take this seriously, because, you know, we got to live well. And John, to your point, I'll say one thing, you know, about the elderly getting elderly, and a lot of that is because they stop exercising, you know. And being in recreation, there's a saying, you don't stop exercising because you grow old. You grow old because you stop moving and exercising.
Inactivity.
That's the best thing that you can keep doing. It keeps the body and the mind sharp. So. But I thank you three gentlemen for taking time out of your busy schedules. Bethel Park, we thank you for listening and watching. May you have a great holiday season, a happy new year, and 2022 is going to be better than the last 2 years. So thank you.
Yes.
Good night.